2 Corinthians 3. And what I'd like to do this morning, and it might be a little long, I'm not sure, but we certainly might cover a lot of ground. One of the problems that I've seen as a pastor and also Bible school teacher and conference speaker and whatever is that people have a hard time keeping up with what's being said in the Bible. Something can be said at the beginning of a book, and we forget that by the time we get to the middle or the end, and we don't apply that. Or something can be said at the beginning of a chapter, and then by the time we get to the middle or the end, we're not applying what it was saying first, and the context of that chapter, we're just going with little snippets or portions of scripture that we know. And what I'd like to do is just kind of try to tie together 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and chapter 4. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, from verse 1 to long about verse 6, it's just kind of setting everything up, and it's using terminology that will be explained more towards the middle, or actually the end of 2 Corinthians 3. And then when you go down to verse 9, I think it is, let me just look. Verse 7, it starts getting into an example of that. And the example is Moses and the veil that was put over his face. But then as we get more towards the end of that chapter, it starts explaining that in relationship clearly, more clearly, to the Lord and to the reality that that's supposed to be reflecting. And then chapter 4 begins with the first two verses. It begins with manifestation and how that is supposed to play out into our lives and what it means practically. So let's begin with 2 Corinthians 3, verse 6 and 7. Who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit, for the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. And if the ministration of death written and engraved in stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be more glorious? Okay, so the beginning part has to do with what he calls the letter and the Spirit. And it has to do with either the law or the manner in which we try to become something and we try to do something for God and we try to excel. And then the latter part of this will be in relationship to the Spirit. And that begins to deal, the specific word that will be used at the end of chapter 3 and at the beginning of chapter 4 will be image, the image. And you know the scripture talk about us conforming to the image of Christ, that we that is the goal. And so that's going to be the contrast, because it's going to be about his image, about his nature, about his life, about Christ. So it's going to be letter or spirit. It's going to be us or Christ. And in verse 13, so let's start in verse 13. And not as Moses, who put, and I'm going to speak fast and because I'm going to be covering a lot of scriptures. And not as Moses, who put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. First thing to notice in there is that he's talking to the children of Israel. These are already the people of God. They're not unsaved people. They are saved people. And he's talking about a veil here over the face of Moses, over the face of Moses. And that's significant, because we're going to find that that's a shadow, but we want to see the true spiritual meaning of that. And then verse 14. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this portion here that I'm about to read, because most of you have been taught this over and over and over again. Tina, have you ever heard this chapter taught before in your whole life? And so I'm going to try to get into the explanations and the manifestation as we go. So verse 14, and their minds were blinded, that word blinded is significant, okay? Their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. So this veil represents a blinding, and it represents a covering up of the glory and of the ability to see to the end of what God had in mind. Even though that's a shadow, it's still a picture of that. It could not see to the end of what God had in mind. And you can just frankly just say it's hiding his face. But it says it's done away in Christ. It's done away. The veil is done away in Christ. Now, we're not to understand that that means it's done away when you get saved, as the scripture will describe. There is a process, and that process involves a growth in him. So, in verse 15, but even unto this day when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Now, that deals with a whole nother issue. Their minds are blinded because the veil is there, but the way this reads is that there's a veil upon their heart. There's a veil upon their heart. Okay, so this is different. Our minds can be on one thing, and our heart can be on something else. Amen? Our minds can be somewhere, but our heart is somewhere else. And Jesus talked about that. And so this is this veil that is upon our hearts that is also blinding our mind is keeping us from seeing a face. It's keeping us from seeing a face. And then verse 16, and now we begin to get into more of the answer instead of the problem up to that point. Nevertheless, when it, and it, the word it there refers to the heart, nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. The veil shall be taken away. So the, when the heart turns, all right, well, we have to see what that turning is, and I don't want to jump too far, but look at verse 18, and we'll come back to this. But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. So this turning, when the heart turns, I mean, anybody, any of you here ever said, okay, well, what is the turning of my heart? Is that when I, you know, I want my heart to turn, I want to see Jesus, I want to be changed, I want his image, I want God to do this work in me, I want it to be more than me under the law, I want it to be more than me trying my best or thinking that it's all about me being changed. How do I get my heart to turn, and how will I know if that's it? Okay. Well, those are all good questions, but it says when the heart turns to the Lord, but really it's turning to the Lord, the image of the Lord. But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image. The heart is turning to the Lord as pertaining to his image. It's not just saying, okay, well, I was thinking today all day about, football. Oh, anyway, and, the Cowboys playing or something like that. I was thinking all day about football, and I was excited to it. But now that I'm in church, you know, I want my heart to turn to the Lord. So it's like a TV screen with football, and our heart goes, okay. And then we're looking at church, and we go, okay, now my heart has turned to the Lord. That's not it. Yeah. And the proof is you're not changed. You're the same. Okay. So then we go, okay, so it's not just turning to the Lord in a service, but I'm going to turn to the Lord. I'm going to turn my heart to the Lord. So I go, oh, Lord, I just want you, da-da-da-da, I want you, and you're what it's all about. That's still not what it's talking about. So then you say, well, I'm going to bring my heart into brokenness. That way, that's what the Lord wants me to be, in brokenness, and that's going to be it. It's not it. It is when your heart turns to the Lord and you want His image, His life, His nature, His spirit in you, as you, and not you, not I, but Christ. It is a desire for a complete change so that you be changed from glory to glory into that same image where it is Christ formed in you. Now, we know Christ is in you. Every one of us, if we're born again, Christ is there. But this forming, this image, this nature, this outshining, this thing that is when, and this is what it's going to begin to talk about, this new creation in the sense of, and I'm jumping ahead, but that's over in chapter 4, where there begins to be this outshining of His life and not our life, not us for Jesus, not us Christian, not us trying to be something for God, but it is Christ being formed in such a manner that it has an outshining that will affect in a certain way. And chapter 4 deals with that outshining. And it's a practical thing that will affect people. All right. So, this verse 16, when the heart turns to the Lord, then the veil is taken away, because then you're seeing what? Well, you can see that over in, verse 6, chapter 4, 2 Corinthians 4, 6. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, hath shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. This is a follow-up to what we just read. And a lot of people don't connect those two, but this is a further explanation of verse 18. And so it is a it is the heart turning to the Lord because we want His image and we begin to see His face. We begin to see the glory of the Father. And this is, in truth, this is a huge part of this right here. And it's a part that some people miss. But in reality, Moses, and I want you, and I just hate having to take the time to explain this part because it's going to take away from everything, but it's really, really important, and that is that Moses was up there with God. He's up on the mountain with God. He begins to see the Lord. The glory of the Lord is on his face, and in fact, they can't see his face for the glory. But the glory is so bright, they put a veil over it. So you have three aspects there. And it really does deal with this throughout these verses, even into chapter 4, that you have the face, and then, okay, so we're talking about Moses, so let's put Moses over here. Moses' face, he's with God, the glory of God is shining off of him. He comes down and puts a veil. Three things: face, glory, veil. Okay, over here you have Jesus, and you look into the face of Jesus, and you are changed from glory to glory. But this also says that to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus. So you have glory there, but that's the glory of the Father. And He's reflecting the Father. But now there's no veil. All right. So, we're a lot of times, we're just trying to see the face of Jesus. That would be like Israel going, we don't want to see the glory and take away the glory, so we just see the face of Moses. Right? Now, this is in here, but it bears searching out, because they could not see his face for the glory. It didn't say couldn't see his face for the veil. Okay, so really when they put the veil over Moses' face, they're putting the veil over the glory. Okay, all right, same with Jesus, and this is what chapter 4, verse 6 is explaining. There is Jesus, but Jesus is reflecting forth the glory of God, the glory of the Father. Okay, and that relationship, to see where Jesus comes from, to see the relationship that he has, to understand that union based on the glory of God, not just based on Jesus' face, will bring change. Okay, so it's good. I mean, we all know we need to search the scripture and see Jesus. But the truth is, these scriptures are trying to bring out the glory of the Father, so that we see that this is, he is a reflector of the Father, just like we're supposed to be reflectors of him. All right, so search that out, because I've just barely got into all this stuff. But there is that desire to turn, the heart turns to the Lord so that we can be changed. But when it does, the veil is taken away and we begin to see another glory. And with that, we'll see through these scriptures another creation taking place within us, the manifestation of that creation taking place in us. All right, verse 17. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. All right, the Lord is that Spirit. What Spirit? Yeah, that's right, I have no idea. What Spirit is that talking about? It looks like it just, you know, jumps in there all of a sudden, and most people just go, the Lord, you know, that's all they see in these verses. The Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is liberty. So the Holy Spirit's gonna be on me, and I can dance in church. That's what they get out of it. That's all they get out of it, is I can dance because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. But it's within the context of seeing him and seeing his face and being changed, and the liberty from being liberated from us and him. Okay, where do we get that, though? Why is it thrown in here, this thing of, well, the Lord is that Spirit, who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. And this is the giving of life, as it were, the revealing of life within us. So that's the change. So that it's no longer about us. It's, you know, the fact is we're crucified with Christ. It's no longer about us. It's about him, but it's about him in us. It's about his image being formed in us. It's about fulfilling Genesis 1:26, let us make man in our own image after our likeness. And again, the only statement in that creation, and we're going to compare creations here in chapter 4, verse 6, that the only statement within that creation that was personal to him was, you know, let there be light, let there be this, let there be that, let there be, let us, let there be, let us make something that we would want, something that would be important to us. Us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Elohim. And so this is that Spirit. This is more than giving law and making us good Christians, or making us obedient, or making us something that we think Christianity is trying to form us into. It is that Spirit that he wanted it from the very beginning. He breathed into him the breath of life. He wanted in a real way, though, in a true way, so that it could manifest back, not just manifest, or not just be in there, but to manifest. And that's, again, chapter 4 that we'll get into here. And so, but that was a heart that turned towards what God's desire was. Let me make sure here. So then, with this veil being taken away, what we see then is the Spirit, not the letter. We're seeing, the veil is over our heart. Our minds as Christians will go after God. Oh, I want to be a good Christian. I don't want to sin. I don't want to see. That's a mind that is trying to be Christian. But if the heart starts tuning into the Lord's heart, if the heart starts finding out what he cares about, if the heart starts seeking beyond ourselves and everything that we can get out of it, but Lord, what is in your heart, then the Spirit of the thing begins to take place. Then the spiritual reality of that takes place, because the Lord is that Spirit, and he is that change from glory, from one kind of glory to the other. Referring back again to verses 8 and 9 and, you know, 10 and through there, where there was a glory of the old covenant, but there's a greater glory of the new. So you are changed from one glory to the other. And that's the meaning of that. That's the context in which all of that is given. So then verse 18 then, which we've read already, but we all with unveiled face beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord. See, what are you beholding? Are you beholding the face of the Lord? No. You're beholding the glory. And remember, up here it says they could not see his face. They could not see the end because of the glory. But he says, not as Moses. So he's saying, even though he's using this as an example, it's not this because it's greater than this. And it's not bound by the realities within that. And again, this is why he goes into this. Beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord are changed into the same image. Changed into the same image. And so this is an unveiled face. The veil is taken away. And remember, Moses put it on there because the glory is so bright. And they said, we can't take the glory. It wasn't that it couldn't take his face. We can't take the glory. And so he put a veil there. Well, in this case, we have an unveiled face, and we can look straight into the glory, and we can see the end to which God had in mind instead of just obey, you know, because he came down with tables of stone. Remember that? I mean, he came down with those. And if that's all you're going to see, you know what I mean? If you don't see the glory, and that's covered over with a veil, you're just going to see the Ten Commandments, and you're going to say, this is what God wants. You're missing the point. But Jesus is not standing there with Ten Commandments, not as Moses. Can anybody say glory to God? You know, he's not standing there with Ten Commandments. That's done away in Christ. Now it's Christ. And Jesus is not just bringing us to Jesus. It's not his nature. It's not his way. The Son is not just bringing us to the Son. The Lamb is not just bringing us to the Lamb. The Christ crucified is not just bringing us to Christ crucified. He, if he gets his way, is going to shine forth the glory of the Father. What did he say to wasn't it Philip? Have I been so long with you and you don't know me? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. It's not about, in other words, it's about seeing me, but in seeing me, you must see the Father. Because we're one. And because he is the source for the Son. The works I do are not my own. They're the Father's. The words I speak, they're not my own. They're the Father's. And so he's always, if he has his, see, the Holy Spirit will talk about Jesus all day long. He can't shut him up. When he gets going, he'll just talk about Jesus. But Jesus wants to glorify the Father. And he wants the glory that's on him. He wants us to see that redounds back to God, which it'll say over here in the fourth chapter also. See, that's the good thing about this. It starts really explaining all of this in chapter 4, and especially the manifestation of that. All right, so our unveiled face sees the glory that's in his face, and that begins to form an image within us. It's not our image. It is, and I say image, that's the word it uses here. It is, let us make man in our own image. It is that we began to be conformed to his image. And again, no longer just Christian, no longer just serving God on that front. Okay, let's go over to chapter 4. And verse 1, therefore, seeing we have this ministry, all right, so there's this ministry, but you have to see it. You don't just, he could give you a ministry, but you could possibly not see that you've been given a ministry. Okay, here's the big question. What's the ministry? The image, the ministry of image change. Isn't that in context? Because there really is no chapter 4. It's just one letter. That's, we're just reading the next sentence. See? It's right there. That's the ministry. It is the ministry of not just us being changed into his image, but that be what we minister to others. Okay? So, and he says, since we see this is what we're called to, we don't faint. Okay? And again, you do faint if you're under the ministry or the ministration of the letter. For the letter... it doesn't kills. It killeth, which means it's an ongoing process. The ETH means it's an ongoing... It just does it. It just kills and kills and kills. Okay? But the Spirit gives. The Spirit gives. But the Spirit gives life. The Spirit gives life. Oh, can you sense it? It's like a tunnel. It's like a funnel. It's like a tube sending forth that into us. And then verse 2, but have renounced. Oh boy, something has affected him in another direction. He didn't just see the positive. He is coming against the negative of chapter 3. Not the letter. Not as Moses. You following? See, we're trying to keep this all tied together so that we can move along and bring everything into what we've already learned instead of chop it up and go, and take it into little pieces. But have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, not handling the word of God deceitfully. All right, so here he's talking about... Trying to measure up to the Ten Commandments, trying to measure up to the law, trying to measure up to what God says do this, when in reality you can't do it. You'll never be able to do it. You need Jesus, and you need him in you, and you need him formed in you. And when he does it, then he begins to carry that forth. He begins to be the thing that God wanted in the first place. I mean, you can become Christian and not receive Christ, you know what I mean? Yes. But if God wants Christ, then he doesn't want Christian. Yes. He wants Christ. Yes. Hello? Yes. So receiving Christ isn't receiving Christian. Yes. And receiving Christ isn't receiving Christianity. It's receiving what the Father wanted all along, Christ in you, the hope of glory. It's receiving the very thing that if you do it any other way than seeing him and seeing the Father, the glory of the Father in him, then it's you. And it falls short of the glory of God. It's supposed to be not I, but Christ. And that's why Jesus is shining forth the glory of the Father. Not I, but the Father. Christ in you, the hope of the glory of Christ being seen. Christianity in you, the hope of nothing. You know? That's why, I mean, even today, in today's modern society with this presidential race, I don't know. They're just things that bother me about. What? Oh, that. Nobody for president. I got that on my bumper, too. Big old bumper sticker. I'm tired of this mess. Anyway, you know how you might be tired of this mess and nobody for Christian. Just Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's what we need, you know? And all this religious mumbo jumbo that we think so spiritual is us thinking that God will accept this, or let's do that, or, oh, I'm going to, you know, I'll do this or won't do this, or I'll do this or I'll do this, or I'll, you know, I mean, and we're trying to make something spiritual out of stuff that means nothing if it's not coming from the reality of Christ in us. And it's just, really, it's just works. have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty and not handling the word of God deceitfully. You see that? And it's in context. This, he's referring back to everything he said. Remember, we're going through this so we can refer back to everything said and build on that so it's all connected. So it all stays connected. So it's not little one scripture here and one scripture there, you know. And I mean, there was a time it looked like most Christians only knew like 12 verses. And they quoted them all the time. Greater is he that's in me. I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. You know, just several, you know. And then that was it. You know, no Jesus, no nothing revealed. Just throw scriptures at the devil or other Christians. I'm just glad that time's passed. All right, but okay, so if it's not handling the word of God deceitfully in the realm of Moses and putting the veil over it and our hearts not turning to the Lord, that's the dishonesty there, then what is it if it's not that? Not handling the word of God, but by manifestation of the truth. This is seeing him and him manifesting through us. See, it didn't say by the truth. It said now by seeing him and him formed in us and we're changed into that same image from glory to glory, we manifest. And whatever we manifest, you can call it Christianity, but I call it a manifestation of Christ.
Yes, choked all that down to TV set. Doesn't this kind of just describe what Israel needs to do in order to recognize Christ as the Messiah?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's there because it's a path that we all need to take. It's Jew, Gentile, doesn't matter. Amen. All right, so manifesting the truth, which is what? His image. That's what it's talking about. The truth now is not a set of doctrines. The truth is Christ. He said, I'm the way, the truth giver. No, I am the truth. All right? So that means that truth coming out of us is supposed to be a manifestation of the one that we've seen and been changed into his image. And anything short of that is handling the word of God deceitfully. Okay? And doing it in dishonesty and all this because we're not being honest with the new covenant relationship that he brought us into by Christ. Not by what he just did on the cross, but who he's become in us since then. All right. So, verse 3. You're going to love this verse. But if our gospel be hidden, it is hidden to them that are lost. Let's go to 4 also, but let's see. In whom the God of this age hath blinded the minds of them who believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Does anybody hear any familiar words being used there that has come before? Almost the whole thing. But how is it that we read that and we don't see all that connected to this over here, and all we go is, I just hope I'm not lost. I hope the devil isn't, you know, undeceived me and I'm going to go to hell because I didn't get it or he blinded my eyes. I wanted it, but the devil made me do it. But if our gospel be hidden, wait a minute, hidden. Does this refer back somewhere? Put a veil over it, hide it so that they couldn't see to the end of what God had in mind? Context? Continually following through verse after verse after verse? That's our first clue. There's a hiding going on. A hiding of the gospel by veils and the devil. And what are they trying to hide? Well, let's keep reading. First of all, end of verse 3, hidden to them that are lost. Lost. This is written about Israel being God's people. Were they still God's people after they put a veil over their face? Yes, they were. That didn't end it. They never saw God's glory in the sense of they were up there and they saw it. When they saw it in Moses' face, they covered it up, but they still took the Ten Commandments. They just re-related to the Lord, meaning they took away the true relationship God wanted and came up with a new relationship. A relationship of being stoned. I mean, the stones, the tablets. You know, Moses was the first one who really had a tablet. He had two of them. I don't think they were iPads. I don't know. I did it again. I'm sorry. But then, well, that's because he was messed up, and the Lord said, take two tablets and call me in the morning. We can just keep going here. So if our gospel be hidden, it is hidden to them that are lost. It's not talking about sinners. It's not talking about going to hell. It's not talking about not being saved here. It's talking about the people of God who are lost to what God had in mind when he came down and wanted them to see the glory in his face and be changed and catch on to that way of thinking and that way of going. And they veiled it up, and their minds were blinded and their hearts were blinded. Amen? Is that in context? We're trying to stay with the flow here. So it's not talking about salvation. It's talking about purpose. They were lost to his purpose. You could say they were lost to his ministry. Seeing we have this ministry, they were lost to his ministry. So, and again, they weren't lost to Christ as Savior. They were lost to Christ as image. Their image. And being changed into that same image. So they retained their own image and added, as it were, religion to that. Okay? All right. So verse 4, because we got to get into this one. This is about the devil. We want to talk about the devil, don't we? All right, verse 4. In whom the God of this age hath blinded the minds of them who believe not. Okay. So he's blinding them, and he's keeping them from believing what? What's coming after the comma? Praise God. You know what's coming after the comma? I'm going to write a song called that. What's coming after the comma is going to change your life. Anyway. All right. So the God of this world has done what? Blinded minds, which sounds familiar, of them who believe not, who have not seen this, okay, lest, and here's it, lest, here's what he's trying to keep you from, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, not just the of Christ, but he's keeping you from the Christ who is the image of God. Should shine unto them. And he's going to explain shine unto them in the next couple of verses. All right. So the devil blinds minds. Whose minds does he blind? He blinds those who are already God's but have not seen the purpose. They have not seen, I'll use the word that it uses here, they haven't seen the ministry. And that ministry goes back to the early part of chapter 3. The ministration of death, the ministration of life. Life. They didn't see the ministry of life, so they're just, thou shalt not do this, and thou shalt not do that, and thou shalt not do this, and trying to shape everybody up with commandments and laws. So, he's blinded their eyes, not to salvation, he's blinded their eyes to the image of Christ. and the image of God by Christ. Blinded to that. Blinded. Therefore, they are blinded to the change into his image. They become Christian instead of Christ in you. Come on. They become Christian instead of Christ because they don't see the ministry correctly. They don't see God's ministry correctly. And so, verse 5, for we preach not ourselves. Anybody following? For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Christ's sake. So what do we preach? Do we preach ourselves, us living or getting better or pleasing God? Is that how do we preach ourselves? We got to get better. We got to, you know, we got to try harder. We've got to please God. We've got to live for God. See, that's a ministration of death. It'll kill you. It'll run you in the ground. Pretty soon you'll just run out screaming. Or is it that we don't preach ourselves? We preach this Christ that is to be formed in us, and we have this ministry, and we believe that the manifestation of it is what's important. That it not just be a teaching or a doctrine or a commandment, but that it be a living person that manifests through his body. Praise God. All right, so verse 6. Here we go with the two creations. For God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, so he's referring back to creation, right? Okay. Hath shown in our hearts, so here's the new creation, hath shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus. All right. Anybody see anything in that verse that refers back all the way through? Well, how can you not? You know, wake up. Hey. Because it's there. For God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness. Okay, so remember now. Okay, I got to paint this picture for you. The first creation. Not like what we think. First creation, there was darkness upon the face of the earth. There was darkness. It starts with that. And then God says, let there be light. And he's referring to this as some sort of way that God works. Outward creation, first there's darkness, then light shines out of it. And here's the truth. It shines out from it. And the original Greek will bear that out. The light, when he said, let there be light, the light shined out from the darkness, not just on the darkness. Check it out. Mallory knows the Greek. Tell him, show him. It's right there. Doggone it. Get up here and shake that Greek book. Because she knows. She knows I'm a heretic. But it's in the Greek. All right, so the spiritual creation then is that we are the darkness or an earthen vessel. It just said that. I mean, it's going to say it. And we are the darkness. And he hath shined in our hearts. Hath shined in our hearts. You see the word there? Hath shined in our hearts. The word in is within. He shined within our darkness. He's treasure within our dirt, earthen vessel. And he's shining out of it to do something, to give the light. There's the light again. Remember? Over here, it was seeing the glory in the face of Moses, and it was so bright they had to put a veil over it. And then seeing Jesus, it is the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. And then verse 7, let me make sure we see that. That we preach not ourselves. We preach by shining forth the light of the knowledge of the glory of God. We don't talk about ourselves. We shine forth the light of the knowledge, or we shine forth what is God's image. We shine forth what is God's image. Hallelujah. And that's gained by seeing the glory in His face as we are unveiled. And now we understand this is the ministry. You know, and that doesn't mean we don't have people back here teaching kids. My ministry's children. Well, that's fine. You can be called to do that, but your main ministry is Christ to be shined out from you, to be formed in you first, and then that Christ be seen and known. All right. He's going to explain that in manifestation here very shortly. All right. So, verse 7, but we have this treasure. And what treasure is he talking about? Why did he jump to treasure? What, you know, what, do you ever look at stuff like that and go, why did he do that? He's calling Christ in you the treasure, right? Yes. And he's calling Christ, the image of Christ formed in you, his nature, his spirit, his life formed in you as the treasure. And he's calling he's referring to the treasure as that which is meant to shine out of our darkness. Okay. Well, I know that you think you're perfectly pure. And in you is no darkness at all. But I think that was referring to Jesus when it says in him is no darkness at all. And so what this is doing is giving hope for people like, well, you. And me. Because there is darkness in us. There's all forms of darkness. There's a darkness of ignorance. There's a dark, you know, of not seeing, of not having light. There is darkness yet of failures, of hurting somebody, of whatever, you know, backsliding, I don't know. Well, and when I said that, I didn't mean that for the person I was looking at when I said that. Patty. I mean, So it said that. It's now it wants to give examples of darkness and light, and of light shining out of darkness. You ready?
Yes.
Verse 8 and 9. Have we skipped any verses? Not a one. Yeah. Does anything make sense? Do they seem to match up? Okay. 8 and 9. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. Okay, so do you see it? This is examples of darkness, but light shining through it. Trouble, but not distress. Okay? We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Gosh, I got a line through mine because I underlined it. I couldn't see it. And it said, mine looked like it said, cast down, but not detoxed. Maybe that's the Holy Spirit talking to somebody here. Cast down, but not destroyed. So let's stick with that. Examples of darkness shining, of light shining forth or shining through that darkness. We go through things, amen? Anybody ever go through something? Anybody ever had some of this stuff happen and you're going, man, you know? But we are not. We are when it comes to troubled. We're troubled. But we are not distressed. He's in us, and so we're not that by Christ. He's in us, so we are not. We're not in despair. We are not forsaken. We are not destroyed. Because why? Because we are not. That's right. So then, verse 10. I'm actually doing pretty good, but we may run over, you know. Tina and I usually go for at least 2 hours, though. So, you know. Now, verse 10, always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus. Okay, so let's just think of that. Always. This is something always going on in manifestation. Always what? Bearing about in the body. This isn't talking about something in your mind. This isn't getting Jesus in your mind. This isn't getting Jesus in your heart. This is Jesus in your body. Does it say that? Okay. And other scriptures refer to in your mind or in your heart or, you know, revealed in you in the sense of, but this is talking about bearing Jesus in your body in a particular way, always bearing him out in the body, the dying of the Lord Jesus. The word there is dying, I-N-G, not dead. You're dead. When it comes to the old nature, you're dead. It's a finished work. You don't have to, you know, sometimes we say around here and we're loose with it, and I'm probably as much to blame as anybody, but we say, you know, you need to be dead or whatever. But the truth is, you are dead with Christ. You know, that's settled. Okay? In his heart, not in yours. Because I see the way you act. Anyway, but it's settled with him that you are dead. But this isn't talking about that death. This is talking about bearing about his dying in your body. It's completely different from Romans 6. All right. So, always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. What is the goal here of bearing about his dying? It is that the manifestation, here we go. Does that word sound familiar? Manifestation of the life of Christ. We manifest this. We don't use the word of God deceitfully. We live based on what's settled in Christ and at the cross, and we live by his life within us to be manifested forth in a particular way. Okay, because he's generalizing. They're about in the body of the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. Manifest in our mortal flesh. Mortal flesh, mortal flesh. Not some spiritual, you know, ooey gooey, abby gabby, no skodamagoda, ooh, spooky, you know. No, mortal flesh, bearing about the dying. The ongoing ing dying, not the finished death of the Lord Jesus. But what are we bearing about? We're bearing about the image. You can call it Lamb, you can call it Christ crucified, you can call it the Son of God, you can call it whatever you want. It's not you, it's Christ. You're bearing that about. And it manifests through death and resurrection still in your body by his spirit and his nature. So, I guess that's enough on that, other than the last part, to be made manifest in our body. See, not manifest through our spirit or something like that. So why are we not, distressed and in despair and forsaken and destroyed? Because the ongoing process of this selfless giving of Christ through us in manifestation means that it has purpose, so that any of the things mentioned up here, troubled or persecuted or, you know, perplexed, all of those things have purpose by a death resurrection process, by self-giving nature that is Christ in you, the hope of glory. And remember, this, he's really gotten into manifestation now. He talked about it this chapter, verse 2, by manifestation of the truth. He's making a big deal now. Everything he said up to that was truth, was teaching, was reality that was settled in God. Now, from verse 2 on down, everything's starting to go to the body, to manifestation. He's using the word manifestation more. He's using the word body more. He's moved into a whole nother realm of living on this earth. All right, so let me see here. Verse 11. For we who live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. I mean, that's pretty self-explanatory, man. I mean, for all of us who live, you know, darkness always gives way to light. Okay? Darkness always gives way to light. And it's we who live are delivered unto death. Our darkness is delivered unto death, which comes by the coming of light. The coming of light puts to death, as it were, darkness. Okay? And that's true whether that's spiritually, mentally, or in this case it's talking about in the body. If you have an area of darkness in your mind and God shines his light within that, then the darkness dies. It's gone. It's dissipated. It's gone through a death that the light may shine. It's gone through a death that the light may live there. See. So, so we, with this light is the light of this nature, this image, the light of the nature of God. And when it shines in us, we begin to be changed into that same image. And then our mind begins to change, and then our approach to things begins to change. And as it does, then trouble coming our way is seen in a completely different light. We handle that by Christ. We handle that in truth, by reality, and we handle that in nature. And so we're not perplexed or cast down or forsaken or any of this kind of stuff, because we know this, and it's going to explain this very shortly, because the scriptures that you know apart from this are connected to it. And he's going to talk about this stuff working for us. And it's all the same thought. So let's keep moving then. So verse 12. So then death works in us, but life in you. All right. So when light shines, death works in us. And that darkness is driven off, and our fears of trouble and distress and all these things is removed. And life out of death begins to be bearing his dying and the manifestation of his life, and is what will be described shortly as the spirit of faith. Let me just describe it like this, because some of you this might help, some because of a class that, and Kelly refers to it a lot. When there is a son, and so we're referring to son right now, we're using that as sons of God. When a son dies, anybody know anything about astronomy and all that? When a son dies, it just explodes, and it just shoots out. It just falls apart, comes apart, and shoots out. It goes supernova, okay? And when it does that, out of that material forms new suns. So when Jesus, the Son, died and went supernova, that was the material for many new suns, right? So that's really what it's referring to here, because he says, death worketh in us, but life in you. I'm going supernova. You're going to have some life out of this. And I know that's not a scriptural, but it's still true. Huh? Yeah, that's not in the Greek either. Yeah. Okay, so then death worketh in us, but life in you. All right, so the word worketh, again, is a continue. It's ETH. It's a continual working in us. Death continually works in us, but life will work in you. All right? So this light that's shining is continually putting to death all darkness. It's taking ground. It's like the children of Israel, led by Joshua, coming in and slowly taking the ground. It's taking ground. Now, we know that the cross settled all of this, but he wants to take ground in our manifestation. Because every ounce of this, again, so then death works in us. What? I thought death just worked in Christ. Jesus died and it's over with, and that's it. We just claim the death of Christ. And we don't. Death works in us. And the result of that is that it affects, it brings life to others, because it's Christ's death. Because he said, we bear about the dying of the Lord Jesus. He didn't say we bear about our own dying. See, this is dying, a dying with purpose. Okay? Then verse 13, we having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe, therefore have I spoken. We also believe, therefore we speak. And so he's saying that this is what we preach. We preach not ourselves. This is what we preach. We preach death works in me, but life in you. And we believe it, so we're speaking this. That's what he's saying. This is what he's saying. Life comes out of death, bearing about his dying. So this is the spirit of faith. I believe this, so I'm not disturbed. I'm not distressed. I'm not freaked out. I'm okay in the process, because I understand why this is taking place. Verse 14, knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus shall raise us up also by Jesus and shall present us with you. Okay, so no, you got to know this. You got to have this spirit of faith. You got to know this, that what worked in Jesus' death still works in Jesus' death now in you, bearing about his dying. It still works. Knowing this, that he who raised up the Lord Jesus shall raise us up also and shall present us with you. We have assurance of the spirit of faith that if we're bearing about in our body his dying, then there's going to be a resurrection. And in the case of verse 12, somebody else is going to get that resurrection. In other words, they're going to get more life. They're going to get the life. Okay. And that it still works. I mean, that's the thing that I was getting out of this, is that it still works. It worked when Jesus died then, and it works when Jesus dies now. Do you have the spirit of faith? Do you have that? Or do you just go through daily trials and call them daily trials, and God help me, and don't look to his life and just look way far away, and you're going, oh, God, help me get through this. Oh, God, help me get through that. And you're just a Christian trying to get answers instead of walking in a spirit of faith that says, well, if God did it then, he's going to do it the same now. But this is the same thing. It's not any different. It's the same Jesus, and it's the same principle that's going on here. All right, verse 15. For all things are for your sakes. See, so we're going, well, why? We're dying. They're getting life. We're perplexed. Why are you saying it's all for us? Well, read on. All things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might, through the thanksgiving of many, redound to the glory of God. It's all things are for you if it redounds back to the glory of God. But it's not going to do you any good if you're just making it selfish and pull it into yourself. Verse 16. All right. The horse has gotten close enough to the barn to know it's time to start running. Because there's hay in the barn. That's a Texas saying, folks. verse 15 or 16. For which cause we faint not. Okay, we understand the spirit of faith. We understand death and resurrection. We understand Christ's death a long time ago and yet working in our mortal bodies. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, isn't it saying that? Isn't there a death going on here? Though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. There's an ongoing manifestation of death and resurrection, or death and life is a better word, going on here. because we believe in this life out of death, because we don't faint over the darkness, because we know that light is still shining out of this darkness and is consuming our darkness as it goes. And in the process, and in this process right here, a vessel, you know, the vessel gives way to the treasure, and the darkness gives way to the light, and the outward man gives way to the inward man. And what we go through, and what we're going to see it right here, what we go through works for us because we have a spirit of faith and because we understand that what happened 2,000 years ago spiritually is still at work by Christ giving himself, laying down his life through us. And so, verse 17, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. Our light affliction works for us. So there is something eternal coming out of troubled and perplexed and persecuted, and it's not that. That it's not that to this person. It is, this is the working and the inworking of Christ crucified. This is the same thing that happened with Jesus on the cross has happened with Jesus in us. And we're involved in an eternal process, an eternal formation, an eternal movement of God that is working something in us and therefore working something out of us, a far more eternal weight of glory. But there's one requirement. That's verse 18. You have to have the spirit of faith. You have to have your eyes on the reality of this, or it's just troubles. You're just going through troubles. Verse 18, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. How many of us have read this and applied that scripture to, well, you know, in the sweet by and by, one day, you know, I mean, whatever I'm going through, it's God is going to work this, and I'm going to be saved, and I'll be saved forever, and I'll be in heaven forever. And we look at this like something about earth, and well, on earth it's just temporal, but in heaven it's going to be. But guess what? That's not what it's talking about. It is staying with the context of this. And it's seen and unseen here. The word seen and unseen, that has to do with death and its results, not with heaven and earth. It has to do with seeing when you're in that situation, seeing we have this ministry, seeing when you're in that situation, seeing his face, when the heart turns to the Lord and seeing the glory. It has to do with everything that's been set up to this point. And the eternal is being in this spirit with the Lord in you, at work in you, manifesting through you, and being in agreement with the spirit of faith and walking in that reality and being with the Lord and being with his life that is wanting to be the way that he always is. In other words, Christ lives in you and not just you living for Christ. And so this is, so what you're doing is that this is the death, which is looks temporal, but this leads to the unseen, which is eternal. It leads to the manifestation of reality, manifestation of life, manifestation of Christ crucified. So anyway, in the multitude of sharing, I'm sure I got about half of it wrong. But the law of contrast can work, and you can see the Lord. You can go back and go, yeah, he got that wrong, but look, here's what's right. So let's pray. Why don't we stand together? Thank you, Father, for your Son. Thank you that you have put him in us, and then beyond just being saved, that you have brought us to a desire that he be formed in us. And that for us to be formed in us is going to be him living the way he always lived, selflessly pouring out, as it were dying and as it were being raised again in us and in others, that process ongoing in our mortal flesh and in our mortal bodies. And Father, we just ask you to make whatever was shared out of this from your heart, make it real. Lord, whatever was wrong or not clear yet on my behalf, Lord, just hold that back, Lord, from them, that they not have to wrestle with it, so that your Spirit might have free course in our hearts, in each of us where we're at, to be able to hear you without distraction, without pull of the flesh, not the old law, not the ministration of death, not even hearing all of this as the ministration of death, but hearing it as it is, Lord, your life-giving Spirit that is in you, Father, and flows down to your Son and from your Son to us, his body. So, Father, we ask for it. We ask the fullness of what is in your heart when you said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. The fullness of what was in your heart to come to pass.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you get a chance, if you haven't, don't know him and haven't met him, please introduce yourself to Don Bird and Tina and